So welcome to this course on electronic circuits. So today we will be dealing with the diode models, which belongs to the unit one of this particular course. And hopefully today I'll be discussing something which is very much familiar to you from your knowledge in the previous semester on basic electronics course. So basically, today's lecture is nothing but a kind of recapitulation of what you have studied in the last semester on basic electronics. So I hope that all of you are very much familiar with this kind of diode characteristics. In the first class of basic electronics, always we are very much familiar in drawing this type of diagram on blackboard. What is that called? This is nothing but the IDVD characteristics of diode, or in short, the IV characteristics or VI characteristics of diode. What does it tell all about? It is nothing but the variation of the device current, or here the diode current, with respect to the applied voltage. Look at the variables along the vertical axis and along the horizontal axis. Make no mistake that the dependent variable here is along the vertical axis, and the independent variable here is along the horizontal axis. So what is VD? VD is the independent variable. What does D stand for? D stands for the voltage. V, you understand, V is the voltage, and D stands for the voltage across the diode. So VD is the voltage across the diode. And what about ID? ID is the current that is flowing through the diode. Now, while discussing the load line in some other classes, then you will understand what is the difference between the applied voltage and the voltage across the diode. Anyway, so this is the VI characteristics of diode. And now this VI characteristics is segregated into two different sections. One is the forward bias section, and the second one is the reverse bias section. Now, you know that for diode, there are two different electrodes. So that's why the name is diode, dielectrode. What are those two electrodes called? One is known as the anode, second one is known as the cathode. So the positive terminal of the diode is known as the anode terminal, and the negative terminal of the diode is known as the cathode terminal. Now, whenever the anode to cathode voltage, we normally refer this voltage like VAK, voltage across anode to cathode, which is equivalent to VD, VAK or VD. This VAK, when this voltage is higher than a specified value, then it is known as the diode is operating in the forward bias region. Now, for the time being, I'm assuming that this voltage is equal to zero. That means whenever VAK is greater than zero, then the diode is in forward bias. And when the VAK is less than zero, then the diode is in reverse bias. So this is the case for the ideal one, ideal diode. So ID is equal to zero, this line, ID is equal to zero. If I consider this particular point, VD is equal to zero. If I consider this particular point, with respect to this point, we can segregate these two biasing operation. One is the forward biasing, second one is the reverse biasing. Now, under forward bias condition, the diode current increases exponentially. Or I can write ID is equal to IS exponential VT by VT minus 1. Now, in some literature, you can also find some eta, some empirical parameter eta present over here. That means ID is equal to IS into exponential VT by eta VT minus 1. Now, eta may vary for different diodes. Like for silicon diode, you have a particular value of eta. For germanium diode, you have different values of eta. So there they have considered that eta is equal to 1. So that's why ID is equal to IS exponential VT by VT minus 1. This VT, VT is the voltage across the diode. And what is VT? VT is nothing but the thermal voltage, as you know. Now, this particular equation is valid for VD greater than 0. ID is equal to IS exponential VT by VT minus 1. Now, as you know, this VT, the thermal voltage, the value of this thermal voltage is very small at room temperature. If I consider the room temperature to be 27 degrees centigrade, which is equivalent to 300 Kelvin, then this VT value, the thermal voltage value, is approximately few millivolt, like 25 millivolt, if you just put on those values. Now, what happening is, this VT by VT, that ratio is very large. Normally, the VT is in the order of few volts. That ratio of VT by VT is very large. And exponential VT by VT is also very large with respect to 1. So that's why I can write ID is equal to approximately equal to IS into exponential VT by VT. So we are just neglecting this minus 1 term. So it looks something like that. So exponential growth for VD greater than 0. So if I consider this line, this VD is equal to 0 line as the threshold. So for VD greater than 0, it looks something like that. Now, what happens for VD less than 0 when the diode is in reverse bias condition? So we follow the same equation, ID is equal to IS exponential VD by VT minus 1. Now, when VD is negative, the applied voltage is negative, then this VD by VT, exponential of VD by VT, is very small, and you can make it almost equal to 0. This exponential VD by VT, because VD by VT, that ratio is becoming negative, and exponential negative, which is equal to almost 0. So ID is approximated to minus IS in the reverse bias condition. So although in this particular diagram, only two types of variation has been shown. One is the exponential variation, and the second one is the almost constant variation. But you know that there are another third type of variation beyond a certain point, which is known as the breakdown point of the diode. Now, if the breakdown voltage is placed over here, then you know that when the applied reverse bias voltage is greater than this breakdown voltage, then an enormous amount of current will flow through the diode. And we normally prefer the diode not to operate in the breakdown region. So this particular slide is very much known to you. Now, let us consider different types of diode model. Already I have told you that I am considering that this vertical axis as the benchmark or as the threshold. Now, anything which is right hand side to the vertical axis, I am considering that diode is in front. Anything which is in the left hand side of this vertical axis, I am considering the diode is operating in the reverse bias. Now, the VAK, which is nothing but the anode to cathode voltage, is equal to VD, the diode voltage. VT is equal to VAK, anode to cathode voltage. Now, whenever this VD value is less than some VD on, so far we have assumed that this VD on, the on voltage, is equal to 0. So if VAK is greater than 0, I am assuming that the diode is on and it is in the forward bias condition. And if VAK is less than 0, then the diode is off and it is in the reverse bias condition. Now, for practical diode, you know, this VD on is non-zero quantity. The value is non-zero. So for, you know, that for silicon diode, this value is like 0.7 volt. And for germanium diode, this value is like 0.3 volt or close to that. So practically, the value of VD on is a non-zero quantity. So there is some non-zero VD on. Now, whenever the diode voltage across the diode, VD or VAK, as long as this VD or VAK is less than VD on, I am assuming that the diode is off. And when VD is greater than VD on, I am assuming that the diode is on. So there are two states for diode. One state is known as the off state, and the second state is known as the on state. So I can always visualize the diode as a switch. You know, there are two operations for switch. One is the switch under closed condition, or switch when the switch is on, which is closed. And the second condition is that the switch is off or the switch is open. So here we find when VD is less than VD on, switch is open or switch is off. When VD is greater than VD on, then the switch is on or the switch is closed. Now here, If you just closely observe this particular diagram, ID versus VD graph, here you find that unlike the previous diagram, where ID VD graph shows a steep rise by virtue of the exponential current, here you find that the current, I mean this ID versus VD, this graph is like a brick wall function. So whenever VD value is less than VD on, the diode is off, there is no current flowing through the diode, and whenever VD value is greater than VD on, the diode is on and enormous amount of current will flow instantaneously. But practically, you know that because of some resistance present within the diode circuit, so don't expect that whenever VD value or the VAK value is greater than VD on, you don't expect that the current will increase spontaneously. And even if it increases spontaneously, then there is some issues relating to the damage of the diode. So this model is all about the constant voltage model. But once again, you know that this constant voltage model is a kind of simplification. But still, to move further from the ideal diode model, we can consider the constant voltage model as the first step from the ideal diode model. So what is the difference between this ideal diode model and the constant voltage diode model? In case of ideal diode model, we have seen that this VD value, or VD on value rather, is equal to zero. That means whenever the anode to cathode voltage is less than zero, the diode is off. And whenever the anode to cathode voltage is greater than zero, the diode is off. Now here, unlike the ideal diode model, we find that the VD on is non-zero and the value is like 0.7 volt for silicon diode. So for silicon diode, if it is ideal one, and if the applied voltage is like 0.2 volt, we expect that diode will be on under ideal condition. But here for practical condition or for constant voltage model, until and unless the voltage across the diode is greater than or equal to 0.7 volt, the diode would never be on. So this is the difference between the constant voltage model and the ideal diode model. Now let us consider this particular diagram. There is some voltage source Vx, diode is present, and some resistance is there of 1 kilo ohm. Now you know that if I consider the constant voltage model, in that case I can always write this Vx is equal to Ix R1 plus some Vd. Now if I follow the constant voltage model, then whenever the diode is on, whenever this applied voltage is positive, whenever this potential is positive with respect to this potential, then this Vd is equivalent to, or is equal to, I can always replace this Vd by 0.7 or 0.8 volt, for example, which is nothing but the Vd on voltage, as we have seen in the last figure as well. So if it is 0.8 or so, now we can easily calculate the current that is flowing through this diode resistance combination. If it is like 0.8 volt, now the applied voltage equal to say 1 volt, what is the difference? Difference is 0.2 volt. Now 0.2 volt divided by 1 kilo ohm. What will be the current? The current will be 0.2 milliampere, right? Now, if the applied voltage is like 3 volt, then what happens? Once again, 3 volt means what? The diode is still on. Diode is still on because the anode to cathode voltage is greater than the VD on value. Now it is 3 volt and this voltage VD is equal to 0.8 volt. So what is the difference? 2.2 volt. What is the current flowing? 2.2 volt divided by 1 kilo ohm. Now so far we are assuming that when the diode is on, no resistance is offered by the diode, as you understand. Why? Let us go back to the previous slide. So when the diode is off, you see this is nothing but a straight line parallel to this horizontal axis. Now what is the resistance offered by the diode when the diode is off? What is the resistance? Resistance you can easily measure by V by I. Now here you see that V is changing, but there is no change in current. So the resistance offered by the diode under off condition is equal to infinite, because there is some significant change in V, but no change in current. So resistance offered by the diode will be infinite. Now, when the diode is on, when the applied voltage is greater than VD on, what happens? You find that there is some change in the current, significant change in the current happening, but there is no change in the voltage across the diode. So, what is the resistance offered by the diode? Resistance is equal to zero. So, just like an ideal switch, there are two different values for resistance. When the diode is on, when the switch is on, the resistance offered by the switch is equal to 0 ohm. And when the switch is off, then the resistance offered by the switch is equal to infinite. So there are two different possibilities. So this is the ideal case. But you know, for practical purpose, we don't expect that the diode resistance will be 0 when it is on or infinite when it is off. Instead of 0, we'll be having very small resistance in the order of few ohms, tens of ohms. And instead of having infinite resistance, you have a very high resistance in the order of few mega ohms. But you don't have infinite resistance or zero resistance. So this is for the ideal case. Now, if I assume that this resistance is equal to zero, resistance offered by the diode is equal to zero, so you can easily find out the current that is equal to 3 volt minus 0.8 volt, that is 2.2 volt, divided by what is the total resistance? 1 kilo ohm plus zero. So 1. So 2.2 volt divided by 1 kilo ohm. So it will be like 2.2 milliampere. So if you assume this constant voltage model, so it is very easy to find out the current that is flowing through the diode. Now, on the other hand, if I consider that, okay, instead of considering this constant voltage model, let us assume the actual model, the exponential model, then what you can write? You can write like Ix R1 plus Vd is equal to Vx. Now, Vd, you can represent Vt by Vt by Vt into ln Ix by Is. Why? Because the current that is flowing Ix, you can write this diode current is equal to Is into e to the power Vd by Vt minus 1. Now I can always approximate this equal this to be Is into e to the power Vd by Vt. Now by calculating for Vd, you can write this to be equal to Vt into ln Ix by Ix. Now to find out the value of Ix from this equation, you need some iterative method, which is not very easy to calculate. Already you have studied this numerical analysis. Now there are several algorithms for there calculating this Ix. So by virtue of this, you can calculate the value of Ix, because here you find that Ix into R1 plus you have Vt into ln Ix by Is. So it's kind of nonlinear equation, and you have to go for some iterative method to solve for the current. But if you follow the constant voltage model, which you normally do in many of the equations, so it is very easy to find out the current value. Now the reverse breakdown, as I have told you, so there are two different regions. One is the forward region and the reverse region. And in the reverse bias, there is another phenomenon occurred, which we call the breakdown operation. What is that? I am not going into the device physics behind that, because already you have studied this one. Now what happens when the applied reverse bias voltage is higher than some VBD or breakdown voltage, then what happens? Enormous amount of current will flow through the diode, and there is a possibility that the diode may get damaged. So except Zener diode, which normally operates in the reverse bias, normally operates in the breakdown region, we normally prefer to operate the diode from this region, from which the voltage, applied voltage should be less than reverse bias voltage, should be less than VBD, and the forward voltage must be within a specified limit. Now, so far we have seen that the diode can be equated with a switch. So similarly, in mechanical system also, diode can also be approximated just like a valve. You know what is the operation of valve? So there is a hinge, there is a stopper. So when the valve is present, you know that the flow will be there from one direction to the other direction. That is the purpose of the valve, to allow the flow from one direction to the other direction. But to restrict the flow or restrict the reverse flow, same is done for the diode. When the diode is on, so this is in this particular slide, they have shown the anode and cathode and the symbols of diode. So this is known as the anode terminal, this is the cathode terminal, you know. Now, whenever this V anode voltage, this voltage is greater than V cathode voltage. You know that the diode is under forward bias condition and the switch is then closed. Or we can say that the diode is on and some amount of current Ix will flow through the diode. So this is under forward bias condition. Now under reverse bias condition, when V anode is less than V cathode, we can say that the diode is in reverse bias condition and no amount of current will flow through the diode. And we can say that the diode or the switch is off or switch is open. Now, while talking about the diode valve analogy or diode switch analogy, let us have a look at some of the characteristics of any switch. Now, whenever for an electrical switch, whenever the switch is on, we expect that it can carry any amount of current through it. It can carry any amount of current through it when the switch is on, and the voltage developed across the switch must be equal to zero. So this is the ideal property of any switch, of any electrical switch rather. So when the switch is on, then the current that is flowing through the switch must be anything, and the voltage that is developed across the switch is equal to zero. What is the purpose of switch? To connect the source and load together. So switch basically acts like a bridge. So there is a source side, there is a load side. And the switch is basically controlling the signal flow from the source to the load. And either it will allow the connection or it will deny the connection. So when the switch is on, for an ideal switch, we expect that the current that is flowing can be anything and the voltage developed across the switch is equal to zero. And under the reverse bias condition, when the switch is off, then we find that the current, no amount of current will flow through the diode or through the switch, and it can withstand any amount of reverse voltage. Whatever be the reverse voltage you provide, but no amount of current will flow through the switch. So these are the ideal properties of any diode or for any switch. But what happens for practical diode or practical switch? Even in the forward bias condition, even under on condition, we can't expect that the current that is flowing through the diode is pretty large or it can be anything. There is a maximum limit. Now in the diode data sheet, the manufacturer's data sheet, there is a specific limit of power consumption. So maximum power that can be handled by the diode. So that is nothing but the I square R loss. Now, so there are some specific value of I, the maximum amount of current that can be tolerated by the diode or by the switch. So this basically controls the maximum amount of current that is flowing through the diode, even under on condition. So to prevent the diode from any further damage, what is done? Some resistance is connected in series with the diode so as to make the current within the specific limit. Similarly, and in the on condition also, we don't expect that the voltage across the switch is equal to zero. So if you follow the ideal diode model, we have seen that okay, the vertical axis is the threshold. Anything greater than zero will be in the forward bias. Anything less than zero will be in the reverse bias. But practically, if you go one step forward, as I've told you, for constant voltage model, there is some VD on. There is some on voltage for that, like 0.7 volt for silicon diode. So even if the diode is on, you don't expect that the voltage across the diode is equal to zero. So there will be some non-zero voltage, that is 0.7 volt for silicon diode or 0.3 volt for the germanium diode. Now coming back to the reverse bias characteristics, what we find? Under reverse bias condition, we expect that when the switch is off or the V anode is less than V cathode, the switch is off, the diode is off, switch is open. All these terms are similar, equivalent, switch is off or switch is open or the diode is reverse bias, V anode less than V cathode. Ideally, we expect that the current that is flowing through the device should be zero. Practically, if you follow the diagram, if you can remember the diagram, there is some minus IS value. So some reverse saturation current that is flowing, insignificantly small. It's like a few in order of microamperes, but it is not zero. So ideally, we expect that the current that is flowing through the diode is zero, but practically it is not zero. Practically, some insignificant amount of current, some microampere amount of current will flow through the diode under reverse bias condition because of the magnetic areas and all. That is one thing. And we know that, okay, for ideal diode, ideal switch, it can withstand any amount of voltage, no matter whatever be the voltage you apply, it can withstand. But practically, it is not so. There is a term called PIV, which is known as peak inverse voltage. So this is known as the maximum voltage, maximum reverse voltage that the diode can withstand. So ideally, it is like infinite. It can withstand any amount of voltage whenever the diode is off. But practically, you know that this current, this voltage is not equal to infinite, but there is some specific value. So these are the some differences between the ideal model of the diode and the practical model of the diode. Now, what happens if we connect some diodes in series? So there are three diagrams here, A, B, and C. Now, in A, the two diodes are connected in this fashion, series fashion. Cathode of one diode is connected to the anode of the second diode. And in B, the cathodes are tied together and two anodes are connected to the two external points like A and C. And here, the other way around. Now, as you understand, so there are two switches connected. What is our purpose? Our purpose is to transfer the signal from point A to point C. Now here, two switch is connected. Now when this potential at point A is greater than potential at point C, what happens? Both of these two switches are on, or both of them are closed. So the signal can be transferred from the point A to point C. But in B or C, you find that one of the switch is closed and one of the switch is open. Now, since it is in the series path, to transfer the signal from the one end to the other end, you must ensure that both of the switches must be on. But this is true only for case one. So for case one only, we find that the signal can be propagated from the point A to point C. Okay, so this part I have already discussed, the characteristics of an ideal diode. So when the diode is in off condition, what happens? When the diode is off, diode off means there is no current. This horizontal line, there is no current. Current equal to zero, I is equal to zero. So what will be the V? V will be whatever be the value of V, I is equal to zero. So the resistance will be infinite. So R is equal to infinite. So this shows the characteristics of the diode under off condition, when it is under reverse bias condition. And what happens here? R is equal to zero. That means what? Delta I is non-zero, but delta V is equal to zero. That means there is some change of voltage, but there is some change of current, but there is no change of voltage. So R will be equal to zero. So these are the properties for ideal diode. Now what happens if you connect two anti-parallel diodes? So anode of this diode is connected to this point and cathode of this diode is connected to this point. So you have basically two different switches as understood by D1 and D2. You have two switches. Now in order to transfer the signal from source side to the load side, you must ensure that one of these two switches must be on because there are two connections in shunt. So if one of them is on, then the connection is established. So if two diodes are connected in anti-parallel, then it acts like short for all voltages. Next comes the diode resistor combination. As I have told you already, we cannot normally use the diode in isolation. It is always accompanied with some resistance so as to limit the amount of current, because you know that when the diode is in under on condition, the resistance provided by the practical diode is in the order of few ohms. Now if the voltage is like a few volt, like 5 volt or 8 volt, supply, then the current that is flowing through the diode might be pretty large. So to restrict the current within within the prescribed limit, within few milliamperes or so, we must connect some resistance, some external resistance in the order of few kilo ohms or so, so as to limit the current. Now let us consider this particular diagram. We have VA over here, which is the supply voltage, and the diode is present in series with the resistance. Now I am assuming that here the diode is ideal in the sense that the resistance provided by the diode is equal to zero. Then what happens when this potential is positive with respect to this potential? So diode anode potential is positive with respect to the cathode potential, then we find that the diode is on. Now if the diode is on, then the current IA will flow from this point to that point. Now since the diode is basically replaced by a short circuit under on condition, just like a short circuit, so I can just replace this diode by a simple wire connection. So it looks something like that. We have resistance connected between these two ends, a simple resistance. So how does this voltage versus current look like? V versus I, you know, a straight line. What is the slope of the straight line? 1/R1. That is fine. But remember, when the VA is negative, when this potential is negative with respect to that potential, so in that case, I cannot replace the diode by means of a short circuit. In that case, these two ends are open. And as a matter of fact, there is no amount of current that is flowing through the circuit. So when this voltage VA is negative, we find that there is no current. So this is the current versus voltage, I versus V, IA versus VA. But remember, this IA is basically the circuit current, the loop current that is flowing through the loop. So it looks something like that. So I versus V, it looks something like that with a slope of 1/RA. And when VA is negative, then there is no current. So it's a straight line like this. So this is I versus V variation. Now, so far here we have considered that the diode is an ideal in the sense that the diode resistance is equal to zero and the VD on, that means the on voltage, is equal to zero. But this is not always true. So this is the diode implementation of OR gate. I'm coming to that later on. Let's now come back to the input output characteristics of this type of circuit. So just try to understand the difference between this circuit and this circuit. Almost the same, but here the output is taken across the diode. Here output is taken across the diode. Now what happens? Now what happens when Vin is positive? When Vin is positive, you understand that the anode potential of the diode V1 is higher with respect to the cathode potential. If I assume that this point is at ground, this point is at ground, so when V in is positive, so I expect that this diode is on. And if the diode is on, for an ideal diode, what will be the voltage developed across the diode? It should be zero. Ideal diode. So when V in is positive, the V out, that is the voltage developed across the diode, is basically zero because it acts like a short circuit. So when V in greater than zero, if you look at the figure number C, you find that this switch is basically replaced by, or this diode is basically replaced by a closed switch. So V in R1 and this closed switch. So basically it is short circuited, this point and that point. So what will be the output voltage? This will be zero. So this is zero, fine. Now what happens when V in is less than zero? When V in less than zero, this diode D1 will be reverse biased. So this switch, I mean, these two ends are not connected together. So switch is open. And what happens? What will be the V out? V out will be equal to V in. Why V out equal to V in? Because you know that V in minus current into R1 is equal to V out. If you follow KVL, Kirchhoff's voltage law says that this V out is nothing but V in minus I into R1. Now, if the switch is closed, if the switch is open, then the current that is flowing through the circuit must be equal to zero. So I is equal to zero. So IR1 is equal to zero. So V out is equal to V in. So V out is equal to V in. So the slope looks something like that. So this is known as the transfer characteristics, V input versus V output, input versus output. How does it look like? Transfer characteristics. So when V in is less than zero, then V in is equal to V out. When V in is greater than zero, then V out is equal to zero. Well, so there are different models of diode. So this particular slide is nothing but the summary of all these three different models. This is the ideal model, the first one, figure number A, the ideal model, where you have got like the VD on is equal to 0 volt, VD on is equal to 0 volt, and the resistance is also zero when the diode is on, and the resistance is equal to infinite when the diode is off. This is one thing, the ideal model, the most simplistic model. Now, if you consider this model, figure number C, this is the constant voltage model, where we find that VD on is equal to is non-zero, like 0.7 volt for silicon, 0.3 volt for germanium. So VD on non-zero, but the resistance offered by the diode is equal to zero when it is on, and it is equal to infinite when it is off. So that's why there are two straight lines. So here, you know, the slope of the straight line is equal to zero. Slope is equal to zero. And how can you relate the slope with the resistance? Resistance is nothing but 1 by slope. Resistance equal to V by I. And what is slope? I by V. So here resistance equal to infinite. Slope is equal to 0. So resistance infinite when the diode is off. And when the diode is on, then the resistance equal to 0 because the slope is equal to infinite. Slope infinite means what? 1 by slope equal to 0. So the resistance 0. So this is a practical model. Constant voltage model, I can say rather. And this figure number B is the practical variation of current versus voltage. Here you see that this I versus V, this variation, it is not like a constant one, rather it increases exponentially. So you can easily calculate what is the resistance. And remember that this resistance is not equal to neither zero nor constant. So I'll be discussing later on how to calculate the resistance of the diode. And here also, you know that this current is not zero exactly. There is some non-zero current, and the resistance is not also zero. There is some few amount, resistance in the order of few, like here the resistance will be in the order of few mega ohms or so, so that the current is very small. So current value here like a few microamperes or even less, or even sometimes in the order of few nanoamperes, even less, the current in that underneath Hertz base condition. And so the resistance is pretty large, but it's not infinite, pretty large in the order of few mega ohms or so. Okay, now we are moving towards a complicated circuit, a bit complicated circuit. Here we have considered two resistance, R1 and R2, and we have considered the diode D1 in series with the resistance R2, and the voltage V out is taken from across this R2, this joint, R1 R2 joint, V out is taken from this particular point. Now, how does it look like? Let us have a look. So here in the first diagram, the B, here we have considered it, the diode is an ideal diode. So for ideal diode, you know, this VD on voltage equal to 0 volt, and the resistance of the diode is equal to also 0 ohm when the diode is on, and when the diode is off, it is infinite. Now what happens? When V in is greater than zero, then the diode is under forward bias condition. Diode is under forward bias condition when V in is greater than zero. Now then, you find that the resistance provided by the diode is equal to zero. So I can always assume that this point, these two points, they are basically short circuited. I can make a short when V in is greater than zero. So if you follow the diagram, so V out is equal to simple voltage divider rule, V in divided by R1 plus R2 multiplied with R2. V out will be equal to V in divided by R1 plus R2 multiplied with R2, because the resistance provided by the diode is equal to zero. So slope looks something like that. So V out versus V in, this variation is nothing but a straight line variation. V out is equal to V in into R2 divided by R1 plus R2, the straight line variation. When V in is greater than zero, when the diode is on forward bias condition. What happens when V in is less than zero? If V in is less than zero, this diode will act like an open circuit. Switch is open, diode is off. So no current is flowing through this combination. So whatever be the voltage you measure here, the same voltage you get here. So V in and V out, these two are same. V in and V out, these two are same. So another straight line, but the defined slope. Slope is one here, and here the slope is R2 by R1 plus R2. This is for the constant. This is for the ideal model of the diode. Now, if you consider the second one, I mean this figure. So there they have considered the practical model of diode with a constant voltage model. So for constant voltage model, a slight change is there. The diode will never be on until and unless this V in or input voltage is greater than VD on. So when the input voltage is greater than VD on, then only you can have this slope R2 by R1 plus R2. And when V in is less than VD on, this diode will be off or under reverse bias condition. No current will flow through the circuit. So V in will be equal to V out. So the slope will be one. So basically, this point, these two models, so the similar type of input-output characteristics or transfer characteristics, the only difference is that the point from where the slope change occurs, or the breakpoints of the slope. In one case, for ideal diode, the breakpoints occur at V in equal to zero. And here, for the second case, for constant voltage model, this breakpoint occurs at VD on. Otherwise, these two slopes are the same. So now, once again, we have considered different types of circuit here. Last time you have seen that R2 and diode, they are connected in series. R2 and diode, they are in series. Now R2 and diode D1, they are connected in shunt combination. Okay, they are in the shunt combination. Now what happens under shunt combination? When V in is greater than zero, what happens when V in is greater than zero? Remember last time when V in is greater than zero, the diode was on and the output was taken across the resistance diode combination, R2 in series with D1. So the voltage developed across R2 will be equal to the voltage output voltage. But here, this voltage developed across R2 and the voltage developed across the D1, they are the same because they are connected in shunt. So when the V in is greater than zero, what happens? Diode will be on. For ideal diode, if V in is greater than zero, then the diode will be on, D1 will be on. Now, if D1 is on, what happens? You expect that this voltage will be equal to zero. This voltage will be equal to zero for ideal model. But here they have considered input-output characteristics with a constant voltage model. So for constant voltage model, you know, whenever this diode is in forward bias condition, what happens? This value is equal to nothing but VD on, constant voltage. Whenever the diode is on, the voltage across the diode is constant, that is VD on. So it will be constant at VD on. And when the diode is off, so you can replace this diode by an open circuit. So what will be the circuit? It will look something like that, V in, R1, R2, because this diode is off. So when V in is less than zero, or V in is less than some specific value, so I'm coming to that specific value, how to calculate this value, or when the diode is under off condition, then the circuit looks something like that, V in, R1, R2. So what will be the slope of the transfer characteristics? You know, V out is equal to V in by R1 plus R2 multiplied with R2, as simple as that. So R2 by R1 plus R2 is the slope. Okay. Now, you may argue that why this 1 plus R1 by R2 into VD on coming over there? Why not simple VD on? So I'll ask you this question in the interaction session. Why this 1 plus R1 by R2 into VD on is coming? Why not simple VD on? Because you know that we know that this value, this potential must be equal to VD on. That means potential across the anode to cathode. Cathode is already connected to ground. So this VK voltage equal to zero volt. VA anode voltage is equal to some volt, that is equal to V out. Now we expect that this VAK must be equal to VD on. VAK must be equal to VD on in order to make the diode on. VAK must be equal to VD on. Now, if this potential is equal to VD on, you can easily calculate what will be this V in voltage. Because V in divided by R1 plus R2 into R2, that must be equal to VD on. So if you have a piece of paper, you can easily calculate the V in divided by R1 plus R2 into R2 must be equal to VD on. That is equal to VD on. So in what will be the value of V in? You can easily calculate that V in is equal to 1 plus R1 by R2 into VD on. So whenever V in reaches that value, then you understand that this potential across the diode is equal to VD on. And as a matter of fact, the output voltage is constant at VD on. And if the potential is less than that, then the operation of the diode is just substituted by an open circuit and it looks something like that, V in R1 R2 combination. So R2 by R1 plus R2 being the slope. Okay, another constant voltage model example. So now we have connected the diode in shunt. We have connected the diode in shunt with R2. Now here, what we find, if V in is, suppose initially the entire circuit is in rest. So we can assume that V out is equal to say some, is having a value equal to 0 volt. Now when V in is positive, what happens? If V in is positive, now the cathode terminal of the diode is connected to V in. Now if V in is positive, diode will surely be in off condition, reverse bias condition. So the circuit looks something like that, R2 R1 combination. There is no diode. Diode is connected like this, but if V in is positive, so cathode is connected, cathode of the diode is connected to V in. So V in is positive. So VAK value will be less than the threshold value. So as a matter of fact, this diode is nothing but is replaced by a open circuit. So it looks something like that, V in, R2, R1 and V out. Now you can easily calculate the voltage, output voltage. What is V out? V out is equal to V in by R1 plus R2 into R1 here, this time R1. So that's why R1 by R1 plus R2. So that is the slope. That is the slope. Now when V in, let us assume that V in is equal to minus infinity, is very large, negatively large. Then what happens? Then the diode, this cathode terminal will be at less potential as compared to the anode terminal. So now VAK will be positive. Now VAK is positive. That means what? This D1 is substituted by a short circuit. Now you see, D1 is substituted by a short circuit. Now if it is substituted by a short circuit, then what happens? So now we have two resistance. One resistance R2, and in shunt with R2, you have another resistance having a value of zero ohms. So this is nothing but having a short circuit, simply. R2 and zero resistance. These two resistances are connected in shunt. So what will be the equivalent resistance? That will be zero. So when V in is very large, negatively large, so in that case the diode will be on, D1 will be on, and these two points are connected together by means of, by virtue of this diode. So the role of R2 is just off. So V in will be equal to V out. Whatever be the voltage over here, that is directly connected by virtue of the diode. So V in will be equal to V out. So what will be the slope? Slope will be 1. So this slope will be 1 here. So accordingly, you have to find out the breakpoint at which potential this diode is becoming on. Accordingly, you have to calculate. You have to ensure that this difference, I mean, this point voltage at point X and this V in, this Vx minus V in must be equal to Vd on. Vx minus V in must be equal to Vd on. And what is Vx? Vx is nothing but V out. And you can easily calculate V out from this expression. So this breakpoint comes out to be 1 plus R1 by R2 into Vd on. So there are different demonstrations of this constant voltage model. Now let us now move to the small signal analysis. Now, so far, we have seen that the diode is supplied with some constant voltage, like 2 volt, 3 volt, 4 volt, or something like that. But in the later modules and later units, you'll see that whether it's a diode or a transistor, normally we feed the device with some sinusoidal variation or some variation having some or some signal having some small signal variation. It is called like small signal variation or small signal analysis. Now, what is that small signal called? What is the significance of the term small signal? Or how can you define a signal is a small? What is the benchmark? How can you justify, okay, that value is small enough? Now, before discussing further, once again, let us consider this IDVD characteristics of the diode. Now, we have a VD over here, the diode voltage across the diode. We have a current, diode current, ID. You know that this is exponential behavior, ID versus VD. Graphs look something like that. Now, if I measure, suppose let us fix any point A on this IV characteristics graph, and if I measure this voltage over here VD1 and the current over here ID1, and if you just find out the ratio of these two, VD1 and ID1, the ratio if you calculate, so this will give you the value of the resistance, and this resistance is known as the static resistance of the diode. So whenever you are operating at a particular bias point or particular potential, then the ratio of the voltage and the current is known as the static resistance of the diode, VD versus ID, VD1 versus ID1. Now, normally, for small signal analysis, what we find is the applied voltage across the diode is not fixed. Rather, with respect to a bias point, so suppose the bias point is placed over here, anywhere between VD1 to VD2, some bias point is placed over here. And over and above this bias point, there is some variation of signal. And as a matter of fact, the diode voltage may vary between VD2 to VD1. Now, if you want to find out the resistance of the diode within that region, then this resistance can be calculated by finding out the difference in the voltage and by estimating the difference in current. Okay, now let us have a detailed look over here. Now, if I consider these two points A and B, and if the currents are identified like ID1 and ID2, now basically this variation is like a sinusoidal variation, it's like a exponential variation. But if these two points are close enough, A and B, if these two points are close enough, then you find that this exponential variation could have been approximated to be a straight line variation. Now, if it's a straight line, then you can easily find out the slope of the straight line. You know the expression, ID is equal to IS into e to the power VT by VT minus 1. Now, if you find out the slope, delta ID by delta VD, at any particular point VD is equal to VD1, then you get that this delta ID by delta VD is coming like ID1 by VT. ID1 by VT, VT is the thermal voltage. So this is the 1 by resistance. Del ID by del VT, so 1 by resistance. So the resistance value will be VT by ID1. What is that resistance called? That resistance is known as the dynamic resistance. Now, whenever the diode is on, if you just remember, let us point out two different let us try to identify two different voltage value and what about the current variation. The current variation, you have seen that, okay, the current is varying significantly, it is varying significantly, but there is no voltage variation. So this delta ID by delta VD, if you just measure, you will find that delta VD is equal to zero and then delta ID is non-zero. Now, what about the dynamic resistance of the diode? For a constant voltage model, it will be simply zero. But for practical diode model, you know that this value is non-zero, but it is small because ID1 current that is going through the diode is in the order of few milliamperes. Milliampere current under forward bias condition. Few milliampere current and VD under, say, 27 degrees centigrade room temperature, it is like 25 millivolt or so. So in the denominator, you have 25 millivolt. And in the numerator, you have like a few milliampere of current. So if you find out ratio, It is like in the order of few ohms, like 10 ohms or 20 ohms, 30 ohms or so. So this is nothing but the value of this dynamic resistance when the diode is on. But if you find out the static resistance, but it will be pretty large, in the order of few hundreds of ohms. So how to find out the static resistance? Static resistance is obtained by calculating ratio between VD and ID. Remember that VD is not like your 25 millivolt or so. This VD1 is like say 0.7 volt or 0.8 volt. This is 0.7 or 0.8 volt. And this ID1, this current is like a few, say like few micro milliamperes. So 0.7 volt by few, say 50 milliamperes, 100 milliamperes. So you'll be having like a few hundreds of ohms. So this is the dynamic, this is the static resistance of the diode. But the dynamic resistance of the diode is very small. Now, this dynamic resistance or the importance of dynamic resistance will be detailedly discussed while we'll be discussing about the small signal analysis of the transistor. Then you can understand what is meant by the small signal. Another thing that I must mention at this point is that let us once again go back to this ID versus VD graph of the diode. ID is equal to IS e to the power VD by VT minus 1. Now, what approximation we have carried out over here? We have seen that this exponential variation between these two points A and B, this exponential variation between these two points A and B, it is approximated by means of a straight line. Now, you know, e to the power x, that particular graph, or that particular expression, e to the power x looks like 1 plus x square by factorial 2 plus x cube by factorial 3 and so on. So you understand that this is not a linear equation, rather it's a polynomial equation, infinitely large, 1 plus x square plus x cube plus x to the power 4 and so on and so forth. Now, in order to make it exponential, in order to make this exponential equation to be a linear one, what you want or what you can make? You can make x, the factor x, to be pretty small. If x is very small, then this higher order terms like x square, x cube, x to the power 4, that might be approximated to 0. So now e to the power x can be approximated to 1 plus x only. Now in the expression of this IV characteristics of diode, you have VD by VT. IS is equal to ID is equal to IS into e to the power VT by VT minus 1. Now if the value of VD by VT, if that value, if you obtain, okay, this value is pretty small, then only you can identify that, okay, this exponential variation would have been approximated to a straight line variation. So in this particular equation, they have calculated the resistance, the dynamic resistance of the diode, which was obtained in the last slide. ID by VT was the 1 upon the resistance. So here, the dynamic resistance is written like VT by ID, 1 upon that. The thermal voltage divided by the diode current. Diode current under a DC condition. So now, when you supply or you feed the diode with a continuously varying signal, then instead of placing the diode, I can always represent the diode by means of a simple resistance RT, and whose value is given by this VT by ID. So once again, since the diode here represented by means of resistance, once again, there is some approximation. We have assumed that the applied variation is very small, so that this exponential nature would have been approximated to a straight line. Then only this approximation is correct, and then only I can represent this diode by means of a simple resistance or dynamic resistance RT. And so now, under forward bias condition, you can easily find out what is the current that is flowing through the diode or through this circuit. And now V out is equal to V1 divided by R1 plus RT into RT. So you don't expect that this value is equal to zero. Last time it was like zero, but this time it is non-zero. The value is very small. The RT was very small. The dynamic resistance is very small, but it's non-zero. For ideal diode or even for your constant voltage model, you can assume that it is zero. But when you adopt this exponential model of diode, this dynamic resistance is non-zero. The value is in the order of few ohms, tens of ohms. So that you can take into your consideration while calculating the output voltage or the current that is flowing through the diode. And this small signal analysis. So what we are proposing here, initially you have assumed that the V0 is applied as the input voltage. Now, over and above this V0, we have some sinusoidal variation, for example, with a peak excursion of Vp. So, and these two, this V0 and Vp, they constitute the overall voltage, that is Vt, the time varying voltage, that is Vt, V0 plus some sinusoidal variation with an excursion of Vp. Now, let us observe the dynamic, the static characteristics or the static resistance of the diode. So, how to find out the static resistance? So, when the applied voltage is equal to V0, that means at this point, the middle point, the current is equal to I0. So, you can easily find out what is the value of the static resistance. This is nothing but V0 by I0 for the diode. Now, when you apply some Vp, some Vp cos omega t over and above this V0, then accordingly, some variation will take place over here. Now, if this variation Vp is very small with respect to this V0, with respect to this VC point, V0, if the variation Vp is small enough, then I can consider these two points. These two points are they are close enough. These two extreme points are close enough. Then this exponential variation would have been approximated by means of a straight line. Then the projection that you put over here, and from that the current that is obtained over here will follow the same excursion. So if you provide a sinusoidal variation over here, sinusoidal voltage here, you'll be having a sinusoidal current over here. But the only condition is that the variation of the signal must be within a particular limit. If the variation is pretty large with respect to the DC operating point, with respect to V0, suppose V0 is equal to say 0.7 volt or 0.8 volt, and we apply a voltage equal to say 0.4 volt. In that case, you never expect that it's a small signal. So the condition of having a small signal is that this variation, small signal perturbation must be small with respect to the DC operating point. Then only these two points, if you go back to the last slide, these two points A and B, this variation, although it's a exponential variation, but I can, if I make these two points close enough, A and B, then only I can approximate this exponential variation by means of a straight line. Now, if it is only straight line, then the sinusoidal voltage will develop sinusoidal current. So, if the voltage across the diode, if the applied voltage is a sinusoidal kind of thing like V0 plus Vp cos omega t, then only I can expect that IDT is equal to I0 plus Ip cos omega t. So, it is only possible whenever the variation is small. Otherwise, if the variation is pretty large with respect to this bias point, then even if you provide a sinusoidal variation, you expect that this x square, x cube, x to the power 4, these terms are coming. So as a matter of fact, you'll find that this current that is flowing through the diode, this ID or IDT rather, this is a non-sinusoidal. So some distortion will take place. To take into account of that particular thing, we have to ensure that the corresponding variation of the input signal must be within a specified limit so that this small signal analysis could have been performed. So I think we have almost completed our today's discussion.